All right, everybody, if we could make our way back to our seats, we'd like to get started. Thank you. All right, did everyone have fun up at the ranch today? It's pretty amazing, right? One of the most amazing places in the world. So I'd like to start off by saying a quick thank you to all of our virtual past attendees participating from around the world. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, but not attending via virtual pass, head on over to yaf.org/virtualpass to log in now and submit your questions for Michael Reagan. You can submit a question using the form on the right side of the screen, and Michael Reagan may answer yours after the lecture. We'll choose just the top two or three questions, so make sure you make them good. Michael Reagan is the eldest son of former President Ronald Reagan and Academy Award-winning actress Jane Wyman. Today, he is one of the most dynamic and sought-after speakers in the public arena. Michael spent nearly two decades as a conservative radio talk show host, heard across the country daily on a show syndicated by premier radio networks. Michael also serves as chairman and the president of the Reagan Legacy Foundation, which seeks to advance the causes of Ronald Reagan held dear and to memorialize the accomplishments of his presidency. He also appeared for years on network television as a commentator and guest on the Today Show, Good Morning America, CNN, Fox News, and others. Michael has authored many successful books, including On the Outside Looking In, Twice Adopted, and his latest book, Lessons My Father Taught Me. He has been a wonderful friend of the foundation and frequent speaker for our high school conferences, as well as on-campus lectures across the country. In the third floor exhibit galleries, we have displayed some letter collections showcasing correspondence between Ronald Reagan and some of the members of his fan club back in his Hollywood days. In one of these letters, actor Reagan discusses his young family and son, Michael. I invite you to check it out when from your free time here. He refers to Michael as our young heir. Now that title is perhaps truer than ever. His commitments to public service and the conservative vision in his father championed are second to none, making him the natural heir to the Reagan conservative legacy. We are honored to have him with us tonight, and please join me in welcoming Michael Reagan.
I was fighting with Mike Tyson today, and he bit my ear off, so what can I tell you? This is what happens when you get, it's called OLD. As you get older, there's things you have to do in life, go to dermatologists and what have you, have things checked out and cut out if they're bothering you or could bother you in the future. So forgive the right ear and the neck. I'm good to go. Everybody enjoy the ranch today? Yeah. Have any favorite parts of the ranch? What's your favorite part? Yeah, no favorite part. That's pretty good. So it really impressed you. That's good. Did you have a favorite part? Nobody had a favorite part of the ranch. Over here. What? The view's tremendous, isn't it? Either whether it's out to the ocean or it's down to Solvang, San Ynez Valley, the views. My dad loved the views from the ranch. In fact, my father was in escrow on another ranch in Rancho, California, after he sold the ranch in Malibu that burnt down in the fire here a few months ago. And when he was about ready to close escrow at that ranch, a friend of his said, before you close escrow, let me fly you over a ranch in Goleta. And so put him in a plane and flew over the top of what would become Rancho del Cielo. And the views, he was just absolutely blown away by. And it was because of those views, he ended up buying Rancho del Cielo. That's why he called it Ranch in the Sky. So you're right on. That is what he loved about it. And he used to always gripe, too. He couldn't understand. He was the president of the United States. And he still couldn't get anybody to fix that road going up to the ranch and coming down from the ranch. It is a train wreck up there, isn't it? Getting there. I mean, when you get there, you really feel like, thank God I made it. And then you say, how are we going to get home? And you say, I have to go down that same road. Am I going to be able to make it? But it's great to have you all here. How many are here for the first time? Really? So I could say things I've said before, and you wouldn't know I've said them before. This is really makes it easy for me. You know, I am pretty lucky because I am one of two people born into a family where the father would go on to become President of the United States, and my mother, Jane Wyman, would go on to become an Academy Award-winning actress. And I always tell people, you know, everybody loved my dad because he was governor, he was President of the United States, but my mother has two stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame and handprints and footprints at Grauman's Chinese. My father only has one star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. So my mother was okay with the Hollywood crowd. But that's how I was raised. Raised in Beverly Hills, raised by actors and actresses in Beverly Hills. And so where would I gain knowledge of anything basically living in a spoiled brat neighborhood like Beverly Hills? And I think it was probably borne out this week. Had I known then what I know now, I would have my father buy my way into college instead of having to, like, work my way into college. And it's interesting. I think all of you are going to work your way into college someday, too. But were you all blown away by all the stories coming out of Hollywood? These Hollywood people that point fingers at you all the time, or fingers at your parents, calling your parents all kinds of names for their beliefs and what they believe in? I always remember growing up, somebody saying to me, my mother, when somebody points a finger, remember there's three pointing back at you. And so Hollywood's out there pointing their fingers at conservatives and making jokes about conservatives, but they're the ones doing what? Paying millions of dollars to get their children into colleges so they can have cocktail parties with their friends who have similar views, and they can say, oh, my daughters go to SC. Oh, my daughters go to Yale. Oh, my son goes to so-and-so and such-and-such. I went to Arizona State University. It was a party school, but I'm here and I'm doing okay. My dad, by the way, went to a little school called Eureka College in the center of Illinois. The college would fit in this room. Still would fit in this room. Graduated with an economics degree back in the 1930s and ended up becoming the President of the United States of America. So no matter what people tell you, it's about you. It's about who you are, what you have become, what lessons you've learned, like I learned from my father. What lessons have you learned from people around you, from your parents, whatever? And then that's what builds you. And ultimately, people see that in you, and you move forward. You don't have to go to Yale. You don't have to go to SC. You don't have to go to UCLA. You don't have to go to any of these schools. When you can say, hey, one of the greatest presidents of the United States of America came from Illinois and went to Eureka College. It was about what he was able to accomplish because he garnered, as a child, so much from his mother and father. A work ethic. He wasn't rich when he was growing up. Like he said, they didn't know they were poor till the government came in and told them they were poor. And then they found out they were poor, but they didn't know what to do about it. My dad just went out and worked. And so he would work during the summers down the Rock River, making extra money to help pay the bills for himself and for his home. That's what we did. That's what he did. And he instilled that in myself and instilled it in my sister Maureen, instilled it in his family. You know, when I was like 15 and a half, back in the day, 15 and a half, we used to look forward to getting our learner's permit to be able to drive a car with an adult in it, and also getting a work permit, which will allow us to go to work and be able to do something, earn extra money. We didn't have anybody hand it to us, but we learned that from our parents back in the day. And I learned it from my mom and my dad. And you're learning the same things, and you'll be able to take that forward. And that's going to tell everybody the kind of person you truly are, no matter where you go to school, and no matter what you really want to do, it's going to be about you and your success. And as you go through life, you're going to hit speed bumps. You're going to hit closed doors. What are you going to do with those things? What are you going to do when somebody closes the door in your face? Are you going to turn and walk away? Go home and sulk? And then do nothing? Or are you going to do what Ronald Reagan did when he was faced with those very same things as a young man? You know, when you went to the ranch today, when you walked in to the ranch house, what was sitting on the right-hand table? You see the Montgomery Ward book? Montgomery, you know why it was there? Because when he was living in Iowa and he needed a job, he went to Montgomery Ward and he asked them for a job. And they told him no. He wasn't qualified to be able to get a job at Montgomery Ward. He didn't go home and say, well, I guess I'll never work again in my life. What did he do with that? He ended up going to WOC radio because they needed someone to do sports. He walked into WOC, went to a sound booth, did last week's game of Eureka College, and they hired him on the spot. And the rest is kind of history. He went from radio. Ultimately, he was out here in California on Catalina Island doing his Chicago Cubs preseason. And that's when Jack Warner called, said, come on over. We'd like to take a look at you, do a screen test. Did the screen test. Next thing he did was go back to Iowa, grabbed his mother, brought Nell out here, moved to California, became an actor. But how did that work out for him? It worked out pretty well for a while. But he also ran into a lot of problems when he was an actor. And ultimately, he wasn't getting hired very much. In fact, he was doing a show called General Electric Theater. But before GE Theater, when the acting career was not going very well, he had to get a job, and he started working in Las Vegas in a stand-up show in Las Vegas because he had to feed his family. So it was about working, getting things done to take care of his wife, Nancy, Patty, Ron, and what have you. As a father, he was taking that job very seriously. And from there, he got GE Theater. And GE Theater was going well until Robert Kennedy showed up one day and called General Electric and said, listen, you have a man going to all these General Electric plants saying terrible things about my brother, the President of the United States. And if you want your new contracts, if you want to renew your contracts next year, you're going to have to find a way to get rid of that guy, because you're not going to get your new contracts if that guy's going to be going out speaking terrible things about my brother. And within 72 hours, Ronald Reagan was fired from General Electric Theater. The show was canceled. And what did he do? He had time to write a new speech. And that speech was called A Time for Choosing. How many of you have heard A Time for Choosing? It launched a political career. Took my dad to the governorship. Ultimately, the presidency of the United States. All through his life, he hit roadblocks. But he didn't let the roadblocks stop him from wherever he was going to end up. And you're going to hit roadblocks also. I hit roadblocks. We all do. Whether it was in grammar school or high school, I went through fifth grade twice. And by the way, let me tell you something. Pretty good being fifth grade twice, because you're the smartest kid in the class. I know today they tell you that you're probably going to never be able to do anything in your life. You're going to feel bad, and what people are going to tease you. No, they're going to ask you what the answers are to the exams. That's what they do. When I switched high schools in my junior year in high school and went to Arizona and finished out high school, they put me back in my junior year. That was even better, because now I was the age of a senior, so I could date seniors and juniors. And I was also the guy with the answers. And when I became a senior in high school, it was even better, because now I could date the freshmen in college and the seniors in high school. So you've always got to be able to turn those bad things into truly good things. It's going to happen all your life. What are you going to do with your life when you hit the roadblocks? What are you going to do with your life when somebody slams the door? I did radio for many, many years. I was driving to San Diego and back doing a radio show. I was one day away from signing a brand new 3-year contract. and a guy named Rush Limbaugh became available on the market. I never signed that three-year contract because Rush Limbaugh replaced me. So what do? I said, well, let me start my own national radio talk show before somebody does it to me again. Let me have my own show so I could do that to somebody else. I started my own national radio talk show that lasted 20 years and would drive to San Diego back every day, 262 miles from my home, to get the show off the ground. What did I learn? I learned if you want to be successful, you have to work hard. I called my mother on the phone one day and said, Mom, not making any money doing this. I need your help. She said, I'll give you some help. I said, great, Mom, what can you do for me? She said, I can tell you this, shut up and keep driving. I said, why are you telling me that? She said, nobody died and said you didn't have to pay your dues like everybody else. And this is the way you pay your dues. And when you're a success, you can look in the mirror and look at yourself and applaud yourself for that success. You don't have to look at somebody else and say, hey, only because. Taught me those lessons. Learned a lot of lessons from my father. I learned about America from my father, riding out to the ranch. Learned about the Marine Corps and the Navy and the Army, because he would sing all their songs. And he would teach me about America and the greatness of America. And that's where I learned it. And I will tell you, when you're 8, 9, 10 years old and your father's singing songs, different military songs, you're trying to get him to shut up. I was like any other kid going, come on, Dad. I mean, he would turn on a radio program playing the Swingin' Years with Chuck Cecil, Little Brown Jug. I'm going, you got to be kidding me. When I got the Beach Boys on the other channel, you're going to play this stuff? I'm the one that introduced him to the Beach Boys. I think it worked out. But the thing is that I was a young kid who really didn't get it, but I heard it. And I heard it so much and for so long that when I finally got old enough to get it, I got it. My father, and I tell young people this when I come up here, my father knew what he believed and why he believed it. And this weekend, you're going to be hearing from some great speakers. And you're going to get some great knowledge, which is going to help you in the battles that you're going to face in the future. And you're going to face battles. You know, during the 1930s and 40s, my father was fighting communism in Hollywood. And when he became president, he was fighting communism around the world. It never seemed to stop. But you know something? He stuck to it, and he won the battle. Ended the Cold War without firing a shot. You all are in the same kind of a battle, but it's socialism today. In schools, whether it's grammar school, high school, college, it doesn't matter. Socialism is on the rise. It's now where? In Washington, D.C., but it's also in Sacramento where I live. I live in this state. This is the battle you're going to have for the future. My father fought the battle of communism. Your job is to fight the battle of socialism. You cannot allow it to win. And it's a battle you have to enjoin. And if you're not going to enjoin it, why are you here? And you're going to gain knowledge to be able to do that, and you're going to know why. Why? You believe something. I campaigned for my dad in 1960s when he ran for governor. I would go out and campaign for him. 1976 when he ran for president. 1980 when he ran for president. And it was really kind of interesting because I campaigned for my father so much as a surrogate that I knew everything he believed. Those rides out to the ranch. Learned all this from my father. Going out campaigning for him. You ask me a question, I could tell you exactly how my father would answer it as if I were him. I got this radio show when I was doing radio, and I was answering questions. The show was doing well and did well. And I got a call one day from a listener. And they always said, long-time listener, first-time caller. And you go like, I think God will call one day and say, long-time listener, first-time caller. But the young man said to me, he said, you know, Michael, we know how your father believes and what he believes, What do you believe? And I realized at that very moment in time, this is in the 1980s, I didn't know why I believed something. I believed what my father believed, but I only got there because he believed it. And so I had to do a real soul searching of my own to find out why I was a conservative. I didn't want to be a conservative because my dad was a conservative. I want to be a conservative because that's what I believed in. But I needed to know why I believed it. Why was I pro-life? Not because my dad was pro-life, but why was I pro-life? Why was I this or why was I that? And so I had to do some real soul searching in the 80s. So when somebody would call the show and ask me a question, I could answer it the way I believed, not the way I thought my dad would answer it, but the way I would answer it. And you got to do the same thing. You're going to start answering questions why you believe something. Because if you're going to win the battle, you have to be loaded with the right answers and know why you have those answers. And my dad got a lot of knowledge simply because he read everything known to mankind. He was a great reader. That generation read. They didn't have cell phones, but he knew how to read, and that generation read. Every book you saw today when you went to the ranch, went and saw that little library, and you see it upstairs here, he read all those books. More than one time. He probably knew every page on those books memorized because he had that kind of a memory. And that's where he gained knowledge to be able to debate whoever wanted to debate him on any issue known to mankind. Knowledge. People who have been here before have heard me say this. Readers are leaders. And trust me, if you're not reading, you will never lead. And I'm not talking about reading what's coming over social media, because that's a detriment to what's going on in the world we live in today. I'm talking about actually picking up books, reading books, and learning history, finding out things and how it all works together to move forward. Reading my dad's books or books from people who wrote about my dad, who worked with my dad, or books that he read to gain knowledge himself. And back, you know, when I was young, he was a liberal Democrat. But back then, a liberal Democrat was conservative. And look how that's changed today. I mean, John Kennedy would never get the nomination of his party today. They wouldn't even recognize John Kennedy. He'd be sent to the showers. That's how much things have changed. And the media? I don't ever remember the media being on our team anyway. We're always griping about the media, but I'm trying to figure out when was it on our team? When did it join us? It never has. And you've got to understand that. We can point fingers and gripe about it, but they're not going to change at all. What you've got to do is change people that you come in contact with. And don't pay attention always to the media pointing a finger at you, because that's just going to happen. My dad, people talk about when he was sworn in as President of the United States of America. What happened that day? Hostages went free. And people credit my dad. Rightly so. But if you remember and go back and you study that campaign and read about it, you find out that the media was basically saying the same thing about my father as they say about Donald Trump today. They hated my father. He was going to start World War III. You heard those words today being attached to anybody you know? My dad was a racist. That being attached to anybody you know? I mean, they haven't changed their tune in forever. They've been playing that same song over and over and over again. But my father, even though these things are being said about him starting World War III, turning Iran into a glass factory, or whatever it might be, he never responded. He never got angry. He never said, no, I'll never do that. Because he understood that when people were speaking, there were all kinds of other people listening. Tonight I'm speaking to you, but we're also being sourced out. there's another group watching and listening. So when the left was calling my father a warmonger, going to start World War III, you had people in Iran listening to the left, and they were selling Iran on the fact this guy may bomb them. They didn't know because Ronald Reagan never wrote an op-ed piece, never said he wouldn't. So on the day that he was sworn in, all these hostages ultimately went free and came home to America. But who went and got those hostages? Ronald Reagan. Because all the other things about Ronald Reagan, he had a great heart. He turned to Jimmy Carter and he said, Jimmy, this happened on your watch. You tried to get these men home and women home. You take Air Force One and you go get them. And so Jimmy Carter went and picked up the hostages and brought them back to America. That wouldn't happen today. That just doesn't happen in America today. We used to be able to talk to each other, what have you. We don't talk to each other anymore. We don't communicate with each other anymore. We got to learn to do that. We don't need to be throwing bombs at each other, but we can be sitting there having conversation. It's unfortunate what's going on in the schools. But you know, Berkeley's been Berkeley since the beginning of time. They did the same thing with my father. My father was in Sacramento. One night, him and Nancy are in bed, and some things happened in Berkeley the day before, and next thing you know, here's a crash coming through the window, middle of the night, goes down the stairs, and he starts chuckling. And Nancy looks at him and says, what are you laughing about? He said, well, he's looking at the bottom of the stairs. There's a champagne bottle down there, and somebody had put a fuse on the top of it and threw it in. And my dad said, only in California would they use a champagne bottle. And he just thought that was funny. He found ways to laugh. He laughed at himself. He laughed at others. He made you laugh with him, no matter what it was. No matter what it was, even in his losses. When he lost in 1976, I remember standing with my father and asking, why in the hell would you want to run for the presidency of the United States? And he said, because, you know, Michael, for so long, I've watched American presidents sit down with secretary generals of the Soviet Union. And every time we sit down with them, they ask us to give up something to get along with them. I want to be the first president to sit down with secretary general of the Soviet Union. And while he was telling me what it was I was going to have to give up to get along with him, I was going to get up from the table, walk around the other side of it, whisper in his ear, "Niet." He told me that in August of 1976? And in October of 1986, he walked away from Reykjavik when he was asked to give up SDI or Star Wars. He held true to his beliefs no matter what was going on. We have too many politicians, and you see them every day. You see them in the votes that took place in the last couple of days. You know, one day they're on this side of the issue, next day they're on that side of the issue. They go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. My father never did that. His belief system was inside of him. So when he tells me I'm going to say "Niet," and he gets to Reykjavik, and Gorbachev says, give up SDI or I won't sign on to this agreement, I knew what my father was going to say. And he said it. But understand, when he's in Reykjavik, everybody wanted him to sign on to the agreement with Gorbachev. Everybody on his staff, for the most part, wanted him to give up SDI. They were willing to give up SDI because they were concerned about the legacy of Ronald Reagan. If you go through life concerned about your legacy, you will never be a success because you'll be doing it for all the wrong reasons. But you live exemplary life and you move forward and become a success in what you want to become a success in. That'll be your legacy. Ronald Reagan did not care about his legacy. Excuse me. He wasn't there in Reykjavik for his legacy. He was there for the American people. And so when you walk away sometimes, that's the best thing to do. So if you're Trump and you walk away in Vietnam, it's better than a bad deal, isn't it? It's about not caring about your legacy, but caring about the people you represent. And Ronald Reagan cared about the people he represented, not his legacy. So as you go through life, don't do it the other way, because you will fail every single time. And most people really won't like you because you're concerned about yourself inwardly. Think outwardly. Think bigger. Think big as you go through life. That's what my dad did all through his life. He loved America. I learned how much he loved America. And I finally came to a point I appreciated who he was and what he was. Because when you run for office, you know, the good news is, Mr. Reagan, you won. Bad news is, you won. Because you are taken away from your family. And now you serve a higher power than your family and your children. So we as children have to learn also how to deal with that. And sometimes it's not easy. Sometimes it's very hard. But I'm pretty lucky because I had two great parents who instilled in me those values. When my dad became governor, I was working on a trucking dock in Los Angeles loading oil well freight from 5 at night to 1:30 in the morning, making $2.10 an hour. I was working. I was working because I dropped out of college, and both my parents locked their doors and said, as long as you were in college, we were paying for it. You dropped out, it's on you. I had to go find a job and find a place to live. Learning lessons all through life. Moving forward. Not letting things stop you. Maybe hold you up, but ultimately moving forward towards goals and success. And I'm a success today because I had a great father. I had a terrific mother. I had the greatest wife known to mankind, Colleen. Be 44 years married on November 7th. We have two great grandchildren. I have a great daughter, Ashley, who's been teaching kindergarten for 13 years, single, because she can't find a guy with a brain. But you can't find a 35-year-old with a brain in this state. They all have cell phones. They're dating their cell phone. They're not dating anybody else. And I've got a son, Cameron, who's a stay-at-home dad, who decided to stay home and take care of his two little girls. Got a 3-year-old, an 11-month-old. His wife does mortgage banking. They didn't want someone else raising their children. And they love their grandfather. And they love life. And they feel very lucky to be who they are and what have you. And someday maybe you'll get to meet them and they'll come up here with me. Ashley's been here, but Cameron also. But move forward in life. Become a leader. Become a reader. Really learn this weekend why you're a conservative. Learn and gain knowledge from these speakers. And then go forward. Because you are in the battle of your lives. You're in a battle for the future of the United States of America. That's the battle you're in. And it's a battle you have to win. As my father won it on communism, you have to win it on socialism. Because they're coming after you. They're coming after, ultimately, your children when you're old enough if you don't win the battle now and win it today. So, good luck. We left you $22 trillion in debt. You know what we do with the money? We travel. Hopefully, you get to be old enough like me to be on Medicare. But that's in the future. It's not Medicare for all, just for old people. But anyway, Fight the good fight. Learn this weekend all you can learn about my father, about conservatism. Enjoy it, embrace it, bring it all in. Go back and tell your family and tell your friends. And win this battle. It is a battle you have to win for all of us and all for the future of the United States of America and the world. Thank you. Here come the questions.
So our first question comes from a virtual pass. This is Tanner Bowden from Spring Valley, Nevada. He says, how do you believe your father would handle the contentious relationship between the United States and Russia or China today?
He would be, remember, it was my father who gave the Evil Empire speech back in the 1980s. If you go back and you read about that, the media went nuts. How could you call Russia an evil empire? Well, it's because they were an evil empire. He wasn't talking about the people. He was talking about the government itself was very evil. And he would be very strong. Both China and Russia understand strength. When, like my father said, he lived, there were four wars that were fought during his lifetime, none of which were started because America was too strong. When we are strong, we have the upper hand with Russia and with China. When we are weak, it's completely different. And what Trump, the problem Trump has is when he's negotiating with, you know, with North Korea, you have a Congress of the United States that's going absolutely nuts trying to impeach him and all the other things, trying to take power away, which loosens and weakens the hand of the president when he is, in fact, negotiating with a foreign power. And that was unconscionable. My father and I would talk about the fact, and Jimmy Carter was the first one to go overseas as president and point a finger at the United States of America and blame us for everything known to mankind. And it seems only Democrats go somewhere else. Only liberals go across the pond and point a finger at the United States of America. The reality is the rest of the world is better when America is safe, when America is strong. The rest of the world is not better when America is weak. And this Congress that we have today is trying to weaken the president, which weakens America, which weakens the world. You want to win negotiations with China and with Russia? Allow the president to be strong and quit griping about it. Yeah.
Hi, thanks for coming.
Yeah.
We visited the ranch and we found out a little bit that when President Reagan, after he was president, had Alzheimer's, he used to live there. Mm-hmm. I have to ask a personal question.
Yeah.
Well, first I should say, my name's Taylor Dean, I'm from Santa Cruz County. I have to kind of say that. But so when did you figure out that your father had Alzheimer's and what was it like having to live with that?
Early 1990s, 91 maybe, he had a fall off a horse, which they think exacerbated. He was in Mexico when horseback riding fell off the horse, and they feel he exacerbated, brought on the Alzheimer's. But his mother had it. Back then they called it senility. His brother had it. He had it. That's why my sister Maureen fought so hard to try and find a cure. I chaired the John Douglas French Alzheimer's Foundation until December. And we just put together a program. We had $12 million in the bank, and what we've done is we're partnering with the University of Santa Barbara, SC, UCLA, University of San Francisco. We're doing million-dollar chairs, matching funds. So we've taken the $12 million, turned it into $24 million by doing matching chairs at these universities to find all the money going for a cure for Alzheimer's. But you know something, you have to find, and what I did, I was very lucky, and my kids the same way, you have to find a way to communicate at the level they're at. And my son would do it with his grandfather. They used to look at a book of Chinese and just giggle. My daughter sitting on grandpa's lap. Myself, so many of us go through life, and we victimize ourselves because something might have happened in our life. A lot of things happened to me in my childhood, and you can read books about that. But one of the things I used to be really ticked off about is my father never told me he loved me. And I used to use that as an excuse for failure. And so I was in church one day, and I prayed. I said, please, God, please have my dad tell me he loves me. I thought it was a pretty easy prayer. And a voice came back to me and said, so when was the last time you told your father you loved him? And I realized in 1991, I had never told my father I loved him. But I was ticked off at him because he had never told me he loved me. And so the voice said to me, next time you see your father, you give him a hug, you tell him you love him. He'd written a book called An American Life, doing a radio show in San Diego. He came down to be interviewed by me on the show. And I fulfilled my promise to God. My dad came in, I went over to him, I put my arms around him, I scared the hell out of him. I mean, he looked at the Secret Service like, this guy's hugging me. And I put my arms around my dad and I hugged him. I said, "Dad, I love you." You know what he said? "Well, I love you too." And I thought to myself, you mean all I ever had to do was tell him I love him? And I've been using the excuse on the other side? And so from that point on in 1991, every time I would see my dad, I would hug him and say, "I love you." And then, of course, the letter in 1994 about Alzheimer's, then it progressively got worse. But every time I would see him, I would hug him hello, hug him goodbye, hug him hello, hug him goodbye. Late 1990s, we went up to visit Nancy at the house. Couldn't visit with Dad anymore because Dad would be there, but you couldn't visit. And got up there, hugged him hello. He sat down, talking to Nancy, see how she's doing. Coley and I had some other things to do, got done. Goodbye, Dad. Goodbye, Nancy. Walked out the door, went to our Jeep. And I was getting in the Jeep, and Colleen looked at me, and she said, "You forgot something." I said, "What'd I forget?" She'd look at the door. Turned around, looked at the door. My dad, who had Alzheimer's, had remembered I had forgotten to hug him goodbye. I, without Alzheimer's, had forgotten. And he had taken, with Nancy's help, little tiny baby steps all the way to the front door of the house. He was staying in the front door of the house like this. I ran back to the house, hugged him. He gave me a squeeze, turned, and went back into the room. I had some great times. As children, any of the kids would tell you this. The greatest times with Dad was prior to politics and afterwards. And I will tell you, that moment and those moments of hugs meant more to us than all the other time we'd ever spent together, because we found a place to be able to communicate when he had a terrible, terrible disease.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful.
Any more personal questions?
You got me tearing up too. This is a question from Trent Myers from Appleton, Wisconsin. He said, "What do you think President Reagan would say about the recent efforts to legalize third trimester abortions?" To change the subject.
Infanticide, you're talking about. Yeah, that shows you how far the left's gone. You know, a lot of people don't know, my mother Jane was born Sarah Jane Mansfield. And her parents couldn't afford her. Left her on the doorstep of the neighbor. She became Sarah Jane Foulkes. They adopted her, and ultimately she became Jane Wyman, movie actress. Nancy's father walked out on her and her mother the day that Nancy was born. She was adopted by Loyal Davis. I was born and adopted by Ronald Reagan and Jane Wyman back in 1940s after 3 days old. I have a niece, she comes up here, Rita. I told Rita Marembi Reagan from Uganda, who says hello to everybody. She wishes she could be here. We were talking the way up. Who's adopted. I mean, we are a piecemeal family. And you know what I say when I go speak to abortion groups? I said, what would happen if every one of the mothers, my birth mother, Irene, Nancy's, you know, mom, Edie, my mom's mom, you know, if none of us have been born, if we'd been aborted, who would have Ronald Reagan married? Who would his family be? And you go like, you are stopping people from having a chance at life. I used to do a survey on my radio show. I'd say, okay, all those who've been adopted, all those who would have been aborted, would you please stand up? And so far, 100% of us adoptees are going like, no, we're really happy to be here, you know? And it just absolutely kills me, the fact that somebody would, but this is how far they've gone, what they think they can get away with, that infanticide, third trimester abortions are okay. It's really sad. That's why I tell you kids, you got a battle. You got a real battle out there with people. People who want to have infanticide, that's the battle. Socialism? Battle. there's a lot of battles you have to fight for, and that is one worth fighting for. And you know, my birth mother Irene, she got pregnant by a married guy, and she came to California and found the Jane Wyman and Ronald Reagan, and next thing you know, I was in their home, and what have you. Thank God. I mean, really, thank God. Otherwise, Ronald Reagan wouldn't have a conservative child. Adoptees are good. And we're conservative. Good.
I was wondering what some of the most influential books to you that you've read, and also what you have to say about foreign entanglements.
Say again now. Which?
Oh, I'm Patrick Warren from Provo High, from Utah.
And what was the second part of the question?
What do you think about foreign entanglements, especially with our allies in Europe and in the Middle East?
Well, it comes down to strength. America, if we're not strong, the entanglements are worse. The fact that, you know, the reality is that Israel is our only friend in the Middle East. I don't care what you think of Netanyahu. They're our only friend and always have been our only friend in the Middle East. And we better understand that because they need us and we need them. And we need to stand up for Israel on every level and what's going on. And which book? The Bible. I walked away from God in 1953. Walked away. I had gone through some things as a child. I was sexually molested as a child at 8 years old. Part of child pornography at 9 years old by the person sexually molested me. And I walked away from my mother, my father, God, everybody in 1953. And ultimately, the only way back was I had to run back to God and stop running away from God and blaming God for everything that was going on in my life, blaming God for giving me such great parents, and say if they weren't my parents, this wouldn't have happened to me, you know, and just fixing blame. I was living in my own victimhood, and I go out and speak a lot to the kids who have been sexually abused. I'm on the board of my church dealing with this issue today and what have you. I didn't tell my dad until April 12th, 1987, at Rancho del Cielo, outside there on the lawn of my daughter's fourth birthday. I told them for the first time. And my dad said, "Where is the guy? I'll kick his butt." And Nancy said, "Honey, I don't think he has a butt anymore." But the guy did have a butt. He died in 2007, and they didn't destroy the photographs he took of me until he died. And I lived with that when my dad was running for governor, running for president, and all that. And so I ran away from God, ran away from the Bible. I had to run back to the Bible. And I got that with the help of my wife, Colleen, who was the one who really held me accountable, said, "Quit blaming God for everything. Start going to him instead of running away from him." And I got into it, started reading the Bible, and really, best book I've ever read and got back to. And I had to get back to it to be able to be at peace with my mom, my sister Maureen, my dad. Dad, in his diary, I think there's the last thing he writes about me in his diary. He has just a notation, "Mike's back." So I've been gone for a long time, and Mike's back. But I had to come back to God in order to bring it all back together, because I had run away in 1953. He had me develop the photographs he took of me, put his hand on my shoulder and said, "Wouldn't your mother like to have a copy?" And I knew I could never go home again. So, as I said, through life, you're gonna find roadblocks. That was my roadblock in life that caused me fifth grade twice, junior in high school twice, dropping out of college and all that. And things I did, I was allowing. Remember this, because my wife Colleen gave me this message years ago when we were talking about this. And she said, "Don't let someone else's attitude determine your attitude for the rest of the day." And I was allowing the man who abused me to determine my attitude during my life until I woke up in the late 1970s, Colleen holding me accountable and moving on from there, telling my dad in 1987 and my mother and my sister and in her bail sin, as I said, I go out and speak on this subject all over the country and all over the world when I can speak on it. So hopefully that answers
thank
your
you.
Question. Yeah, thank you.
This question comes from Luke Matsui from San Francisco in Balboa High School. He said, what do you think Ronald Reagan would feel or respond to the silencing of conservatives through social media and news media today?
Well, he'd be outraged by it. He'd be absolutely outraged by it. The fact that they tried to silence him too. And now it's even bigger with all the social media that's in fact out there. You have to be a loud voice. You have to understand who you're doing battle against and what have you, and you've got to be unified. I mean, this is one thing I hand it to the Democrats. They'll be unified. They'll drive you off a cliff, but they'll all be in the bus driving you off the cliff. You know, and one thing about Republicans is it's hard to put three of them together in a phone booth, as you're finding out and as the president just found out with this vote on the border. I mean, the reality of it is, and I tweeted this at Reagan World, my Twitter account, by the way, I tweeted this the other day. I said, the Congress of the United States gave the president no choice but to lay down that veto today. They have had 33 years to come up with immigration policy since 1986 in Simpson-Mazzoli, and they haven't come up with an immigration policy. Why? Because they'd rather have the policy. They'd rather have the issue than solve the problem. Because they love people raise money on it. You know, whether you're for it or against the wall, you get money, you send out flyers, if they ever solve the problem. But they've had 33 years, and the Democrats, who have been in charge since January, haven't come up with an immigration bill. But at some point in the last 33 years, both parties, at one point, have controlled all three branches of government and never given you an immigration policy. And so, the president is forced to put this veto forward to, in fact, put a wall on the southern border. I tell you, you guys are young. I took my wife, Colleen, to Tijuana on our first anniversary. Am I a nice guy or what, huh? She's from Nebraska. What the hell does she know? Tijuana, that sounds great. Let's go. But, you know, you could go to Tijuana on your first anniversary in 1976, but not today. It's not safe. You need a barrier. Wherever there's a barrier, it's a safer part of the border. And that's just fact. And so the President of the United States is right. I think the President of the United States, my dad, would be outraged by what's going on. And he would say, there they go again. You've had 33 years. You've come up with nothing. Come up with nothing. It's time that these parties come up with an immigration policy.
Hello. Thank you for coming tonight. My name is Mason Strand from New Braunfels, Texas, and I go to Canaan High School. My question is how your father found a way to balance his personal life with Nancy Reagan and you and all of his family with his political life and how we can maybe do that in our lives today.
You have to find a way. Nancy, stay-at-home mom. You know, she gave up acting when they had Patty and then Ron. You got to have that person at home is willing to pull you aside and say, okay. And the ranch was my dad's getaway. You know, it's like when he became president-elect, the Secret Service will cover one home other than the White House. You get to pick the home. You notice he sold the home he lived in the Palisades, and you do the ranch. I'm keeping the ranch. That was his getaway. And he was able to use that, and that's where we all would go for Thanksgiving, what have you. That's where the family could get together without having media all over the building, if you will. So you need to do that. My wife does it in my family. I mean, every morning I get up, girls, you want to write this down, and guys too. Every morning I get up, and tomorrow morning I'll get up at 8 o'clock, put the dogs out, feed the dogs. I'll grind fresh coffee. At 9 o'clock I'll take a fresh cup of coffee to Colleen, and we'll have it upstairs in our sitting room, watch the news, and drink coffee. Spend an hour together at night. When she comes home from work, we get home, I spend an hour at night. Too many times, we get too busy to take care of our own family. You never need to be that busy. You never need to be that busy. And Dad found a way with the ranch. The ranch was that spot where the family could go. Colleen, she makes sure that there's family time. When my dad left the White House on, what, January 20th, 1989, I looked at Colleen, I said, I've done my last weekend. And Young Americans Foundation will tell you, they call me, I don't do weekends. Because once you start, you'll never finish. Oh, you did Saturday for those people, well, you do Saturday for them. You've got to block it and say, no, weekends are family, that's just the way it is, and what have you. My dad, I learned that from my dad. The ranch, I'm at the ranch. That's what he was doing. You got to find your own ranch. But I will tell you this, I didn't tell you this story tonight. Good Friday, 1988, I'm flying back from the White House with my father. And hitched a ride with him, spent the night at the White House, kind of cool. And as we're landing at Point Magoo, he counts out the number 9 on his fingers. I said, what is significant about number 9? He said, in 9 more months, I said, this is 87. He said, 9 more months, I'll no longer be president of the United States. I said, really? I said, is that important to you? He says, yes. I said, why? He said, well, he says, you know, ever since I was shot, I haven't gone to church on a regular basis. And I've really missed not going to church because I haven't wanted to put other people in harm's way if someone wants to come in there and do bodily harm to me. And I remember looking out the window of the limousine that day, you know, March 30th back in 1981 and seeing people laying in their own blood what bullets meant for me. So I'm looking forward to no longer being present so I can start going back to church. And I said to him as we got off the plane at Point Magoo, I said, well, why don't you go this Sunday, go to church up there in Santa Ynez? He said, well, it's not on the schedule. And I said, okay. And I went home and went to church. And I found out about 7 years ago, John Barletta, who passed away John Barletta heard me tell that story. He said, you're the guy. I said, well, yeah, I'm the guy. He said, Mike, just to let you know, he went to church that Sunday. It wasn't on the schedule. But he went that Sunday to church down in Santa Ynez. They had to roust everybody up to go. But when he got out of the White House and went home, he never missed church again until he had Alzheimer's. But then the pastor would come to the house and visit with my dad. And the pastor would always say, I went to minister to the president, but I ended up having him minister to me. So you got to find that. You got to find your ranch.
Thank you.
Question number 2. No good.
So I'm John Harding. I'm from Scotts Valley, California, just up the coast.
Where?
Scotts Valley, California, okay. Santa Cruz.
Yeah.
And I just, as a Californian, it's kind of crazy to see what our state has come to compared to other states in the union. And it used to be the state of Reagan, and I just wanted to ask you, like, what happened, basically, if you can answer that.
No leadership. There is no Republican Party in the state. There's absolutely no leadership in the state. They have no voice. They have no issues. I was talking to a friend of mine who heads up the Senate in Sacramento the other day. She's great. I love her. But I said, you know, the problem is in this last election, nobody knows what a Republican stands for in the state of California. Have no idea. And there's so many issues. I mean, if I was running for governor, I'd be showing pictures of San Francisco all day long and say, this town could be yours. Vote for him. You can have it everywhere. You want sanctuary state? Vote for that guy. There's so many issues here that you could use as a Republican, and they don't. There's no leadership. They have no issues. They don't know what they stand for at all. And that's really sad. The man, John Cox, who ran for governor of state, my wife and I and my daughter volunteered to work with him, went to an event he had down Newport Beach, volunteered. Two weeks before the election, I called him. I said, John, I haven't seen an ad. Nobody's called for your campaign to have me go out and be a surrogate speaker for you and help you out? He said, well, we don't need you. I said, why? Well, you're a Reagan and you're a Republican. We already have the Republican vote, so there's no need to use you. I said, oh, okay. Thank you, John. I mean, that's the leadership of the state of California for the Republican Party. We don't need you out campaigning for me in California because you're a Reagan and you're a Republican, so I already have the Republican vote. Well, guess what? He didn't get all the Republican vote. You can't have that. You got to have leadership, and there's no leadership. And hopefully the new person they just elected to lead the state of California, Jackie, I think her name, hopefully she turns it around, finds some issues, and turns this party around and puts it in the right direction. But right now, it's got no direction. Well, two-thirds majority in both the Assembly and the State Senate. You know, you have basically every Republican lost the congressional race. You have Washington, D.C., the RNC's given up on California because we give them no reason to pat us on the back. We're losers. You know, they don't want to listen. So there you go. My problem is I have 50 or 60 years of knowledge being with my dad, and I go to try and help these people sit down. I came up with like 3 or 4 ads for John Cox to run, ran them through Mark Meadows, thought they were great, and so on. But what happens, these people only see my name, and they want me to endorse them. So they say, oh, like I gave them the mantle of Ronald Reagan, endorsed them. They don't want to listen to the knowledge I have of 50 years, from 1960s, my dad campaigning, to 1984, running for president. I mean, I have a few years behind me on this stuff, but they only want my last name. They don't want the knowledge I can give them to help them get through a campaign and win. And when that changes, maybe everything else will change.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. My name is Justin Smith. I'm from Paso Robles, California. And first of all,
I'll be up there. Paso, great wine country.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. First of all, I just want to start off by saying that anyone that really knows me knows that your father and Jesus Christ were the two biggest inspirations in my life. And my question is what advice would you give to us high school students that are fighting the conservative fight here, especially in the liberal parts of the country, and what words of inspiration would you give us to keep continuing that fight?
What I was saying tonight, know why you believe what you believe. You don't say, well, Ronald Reagan said or whatever. Be who you are. You get quoted. All right? You know, what's your first name?
Justin.
You know what Justin said today? What Justin said was unbelievable what he said. Not what Ronald Reagan was 1980s. You're learning about him, but you read quotes from Ronald Reagan. But how about coming up with your own quotes, your own knowledge? So people say, hey, is Justin cool? Do you hear what Justin had to say? Justin's not quoting Ronald Reagan. He's coming up with these ideas, his ideas, what he wants to do. And I'm behind that. And that's such a powerful place to be. That's leadership. And that's what you all have to do. You have to find a way to really lead and get out there and have people quoting you what's great about America. Why are we great? Don't tell them we're great because Ronald Reagan said we are great. You tell them why you think America is great. So they're quoting Justin. Justin said America's great because. And you start doing that, you'll start winning the arguments. They won't see you as somebody else. They'll see you as you, a leader. And this group needs to be, all of you need to be seen as individual leaders within your community. And that just knocks the socks off the liberals. Because you're going to hear it. You're racist. You're everything known to mankind. Everything known to mankind. That's going to happen. Don't let someone else's attitude determine yours for the remainder of the day. That help you?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Josh.
I don't have all the answers up here, but I'm working on it. Go ahead.
Okay. My name is Joshua Purnell, and I'm... Something broke? Okay. Yeah. Yeah. something broke. I'm living in Castaic, California.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, considering the work ethics you gained from your parents, what is your opinion on today's culture when it comes to the opinion on college and what it's for?
Yeah, well, it's for so you can sell makeup on YouTube, unless you get caught. No, what college is for, you know, college has changed so much over the years. It used to be the place where every parent sent their daughter to find a husband. That's the way it was back in the day. Yeah, send her to that school. They got great guys over there to marry. That's the way it was. And then that just evolves. I think college is good if you really have a career you're thinking about, where you want to go, what you want to do, and you want to be a nurse, you want to be a lawyer, you want to be a doctor, what have you. But I don't think college is for everybody. I mean, college is not for everybody. Entrepreneurial stuff. You're not going to learn that in school. You may want to take a business class, get a business degree, but you're not going to learn to be an entrepreneur. You either got that or you don't have it, and what have you. So I really don't think it's everybody. My daughter Ashley was the first Reagan to graduate from college after her grandfather. It was dad back in the 1930s from Eureka, and Ashley from, you know, Cal Lu in 2005. And then she got her master's degree at Pepperdine. So somehow we've made it. I've always been in sales and marketing. Don't learn that in college. It's really funny. My dad was on ABC one night with Tom Gerald, the night 1984, the night he was accepting the nomination for the second term. And I had just set a world record in a powerboat between Ketchikan, Alaska, and Seattle to raise money for Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, raised $250,000. And I had Tom Gerald from ABC in the boat. And he was able to get an interview with my dad. And so he asked my dad, I said, when did you know Mike was going to be okay? Oh, he says, that's so easy. He said, we had a ranch in Malibu with a lot of white fences. I used to pay Mike to paint the white fences during the summer. That's how he made money. And I paid 10 cents a board, you know, for the length of the board, and 15 cents a post. And Tom said, yes. He said, one day I was riding out to the ranch, and I saw three young boys painting the fence, and no Mike. And I stopped. I said, what's your name? They introduced themselves, and I said, where is Mike? Well, he's at the beach. So he's at the beach. And he said, so I asked him, I said, well, is he paying you to paint the fence? I found out that Mike was paying them half of what I was paying him to paint the same fence. And I thought to myself, Mike's going to be okay. He had subcontracted out the painting of the fence. It was a warm day, and he was at the beach. I didn't learn that in college. You know, there's some things you learn in college, but it's not for everybody. It's for people who I think are targeted, where they want to go, things that they want to do. Some people go there just to party. I went to Arizona State. None of the people I went to school with would ever qualify for the Supreme Court. None of us. We had drinking games every night. You know, when they had football games at Arizona State University, they say, okay, everybody from ATO, stand up. Yay, Sigma Chi, yay. And at the end of the thing, everybody on social probation, the whole stadium went nuts. You know? So we would never be on the Supreme Court, but we had a great time, and what have you. I wish I would have finished college, but that's on me, and my parents maybe pay the price for it. You know, work out a trucking dock in L.A. when your dad's becoming governor, and the guys on the trucking dock are trying to tell you your parents don't love you, and you say, no, they do, and you start to believe them because you're thinking to yourself, I'm working on a trucking dock in downtown Los Angeles. My dad's going to be governor. Maybe they don't love me, but they did love me, and they taught me that lesson. That's on you. You quit college, get a job, find a place to live. So there you go.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So we have one final question for you to end the evening. This is from Gary Brown in California.
Jerry Brown, did you say?
Yeah, right. His question is, what would your father say to the conservatives in Congress that vote on the left on issues like the border national emergency?
Well, you know, my dad, again, you've had 33 years to get this thing together, and you didn't do it. So I think he would call them out. You should have written a bill, given him a bill if he, during the presidency, whatever, that he could, in fact, sign. But nobody gave anybody a bill to sign. And so when you have a Congress that is not doing its job, but I will tell you this, the other side of the coin, I would rather vote for a liberal Republican than a Democrat, because I know where the Democrats are going to be each and every day. And maybe that liberal Republican can move over at some point in time. But the Republicans need to start standing together and moving forward, because the Democrats are at war with them, and they're going to hang together. And the Republicans better figure out they've got to hang together, too, if they're going to win. Like, you all have to win, hang together to win on socialism. The Republicans in Congress have to start, you know, being together all the way through it. And my dad would hold them accountable for not giving him a bill that he could sign that would take care of the border issue in America. As I said, 33 years. Simpson-Mazzoli was 1986. And you know what Simpson-Mazzoli promised? President, you give us, you know, you allow these people to come here and give them amnesty, we'll make the border secure. That was 1986. Did you all know what the other side of that issue was? Here's something good to read. Read Simpson-Mazzoli, because there was two parts to it. One part was amnesty. All right. Yeah. The other part was the Democrats saying, and we'll give you border security. We'll give you what you need on the border to make the border secure. Well, amnesty happened. Are we still waiting? We're still waiting for the border security, right? Yeah. My dad's in his grave saying, when? When? And that's what he would be saying. So they lied to him in 1986, and they've never stopped. Again, thank you so much. Appreciate it.